I'm going to pose a question that I think every one of us have asked at one time in our life or another, or many times in our life, especially when we go through hardships or difficult times. Jesus, where are you? Where are you, Lord? And I can't help but think about, as I look back, I can't help but think about the many times when I was little. My mom used to say, Kath, please go and get me this, or, I need you to go in the hallway, in the closet, get the can of something out of the, and so I would go, and it's like, I can't find it. And so, what does mom say? Pretend there's candy over there in that closet, right? Pretend there's candy there, and you will find it. Have you ever had or tried to have a conversation with someone who is on the computer as you're talking, you're trying to have a conversation, and they're on the computer or their iPad or pad or whatever it is? On the other line, especially, you're on the phone with somebody, you can hear click, 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 click. Huh? Click. Oh? It's nerve-wracking, but Jesus, it's impossible. Jesus could not be any closer to us than what he is to us here on earth, except full-time in eternity one day, when we are before his throne, praising and honoring and loving him. He did not abandon us. He gave us ways to be with us consistently. And we can hold him to his word. I will be with you always. Be anxious for nothing. I think about 1 Kings chapter 3, verses 5 through 15. King Solomon. And here's this king's son, ready to be crowned. If he wasn't already, I'm not sure. I gotta read that part again. But obviously, in succession to King David, his son Solomon. And in this prophetic dream, God asks him, what do you want? He's favored. God loved David. God loves Solomon, this son. Asked, son, what do you want? And Solomon asked for what is quite unique today in our times, probably back then too. Grant me an understanding heart. An understanding heart. Wisdom. Grant me an understanding heart. Saint Mother Teresa, her life radically changed at the simple words from Jesus Christ, I thirst. My life radically changed when he said, I desire healing. And one by one, every one counts to leave everything and to follow him. And for all of us, day by day, to come to Holy Mass, to fulfill our prayerful obligations, to lead that sacramental life, we abandon the stuff that, could be getting done, etc., to walk in his footprints. And so then the next question that comes to me, to my mind, is, Jesus, are you talking to me? I think that in this past month, I've heard that question so many times from other people. Are you talking to me? Am I hearing voices? Is this my imagination? Oh, I'm not worthy. exactly what Father was saying in his homily today about the evil one working overtime and trying to rob us of our peace is right on target. That's his job. He will tap on those raw nerves to remind us of the past hurts, especially deep wounds, offenses. And the only real way to overcome all of that is to have the understanding heart that Solomon prayed for and asked God for. And to understand somebody what is necessary. Envision yourself being with another person. What key thing is necessary to understand them? What must you be doing? Does anybody know?
Listening.
Listening. Listening can only be done if we're not talking. If we're not on the computer trying to say a prayer or do whatever, we're in the car trying to watch traffic, and I mean, there's nothing wrong with putting the rosary on as you're driving. It's a beautiful thing. But really, listening is an art, is a gift that has been lost. Everyone is given, well, not everyone. There are those people that don't have hearing, but that's not what I'm talking about. For the most of us who do have hearing, and even a deaf person can hear the voice of God. It goes beyond any limitations of the human being. What God gives far surpasses, and God can speak in any way, shape, form, moment, second that he wants to. And so having that understanding is to have the listening. Listening is not just hearing. Listening is not, you know, just having stuff come over us, you know, That's not listening. Listening is stopping and paying attention to who it is that is trying to say something. And the most important someone that we need to do this with is the Lord. It's Jesus. We can never have a real interior relationship with God, Jesus Christ himself, if we don't listen. And so, you know, the question comes, well, how do I do that? And I listen and I don't hear. You're not listening. God teaches us throughout history, in the scriptures, and in so many different ways. It's not in the whirlwind, in the hurricane, in the wind. It's in the still small voice. And God speaks as he pleases. Sometimes God uses words. Most times it's a divine inspiration. But you have to be listening with the ear of your soul. First, we come to it with our bodies, our ears. We come to this time. If we really want a powerful life, powerful spiritual life, and we really want to go to heaven and be with God one day, and we really want in this life to walk with the Spirit of God and not always guessing, and we want to hear him, and we have to listen. And so I recommend that as we carve out this private time, and it has to be private. That's why he says, go to your room or closet and shut the door. It's by yourself because you came in. You were in by yourself, and then you will go in one day. When it's time for that last breath, you're not taking somebody with you. That transition time, you're going to be there alone with the Lord, hopefully. And so It's by carving this time out, however it works for you. But most assuredly, find a spot somewhere in the church, at chapel, to come before him in the Blessed Sacrament. I always feel safest. I have my prayer room, and I take very seriously. Now, a lot of good stuff happens there, but it's before the Blessed Sacrament that something very special. It's like spiritual healing, radiation, if you will, that God does. And maybe, like me sometimes, I've got a lot going on, there's a lot in my mind, I find it hard to settle down. So I will sing a song. I start by, you know, kind of working the bugs out, if you will, by singing a song. And so it may be I have a missal in my prayer room, or here in the chapel when I'm here alone. I will open that book up, or sometimes one that I remember from the sisters that taught me in catechism, a song that just comes to my heart, and I just sing. It doesn't matter what it sounds like. Sometimes it's good, sometimes it's not so good, sometimes it's soft. But until I feel that peace starting, and just coming to it, and I listen to the words of the song, the words, you know, that I learned, the words that I'm saying to God, and it brings me into that moment with God. And then a soft prayer. And it just depends. I love in the scriptures, in Ephesians, where it says praying in the Spirit. To me, that's allowing God to direct my prayer time. Just because I love to pray the Chaplet of Divine Mercy and the Holy Rosary of Our Lady doesn't mean that I'm going to pray that every single time I come to my prayer time. I may pray just a decade of the Rosary at that particular prayer time. I always try to pray my Rosary daily. But that could be at any time, but it's when I want and I'm trying to listen, it helps me to enter into, after some kind of song and working at those heebie-jeebies, whatever, and then beginning of a prayer. It may be a Hail Mary, it may be an Our Father, or whatever that, however the Holy Spirit leads you. Go with it. And don't worry. Don't worry that, oh, this is the only 1 hour that I have, and if I don't say my rosary in my chaplet right now, I'm not going to get it in today, blah, blah, blah. God will open up the time for you. And remember, there is no, well, our time is not like God's time. Don't let the devil get you into the trap of being into this methodology of this is the only way I can pray to go to heaven. I have to say these prayers and all of this novenas and all of these things. Let the Holy Spirit work within your heart and soul, and don't be afraid. You have nothing to fear. As long as you're leading a sacramental life, Eucharist, reconciliation, regularly, the tribunal of His mercy, then you have nothing to worry about. I'm not saying don't pray the rosary. I'm just saying don't be hung up by those beads, those precious, precious beads. And I love the rosary. I love the chaplet. I love the novenas. But if I sense God is calling me to some other kind of prayer, I go with that. Because 9.5 out of 10 times, it transcends to something entirely new. And it's there with God that my heart is joined. In our hearts. And most times, it comes in total silence. Total silence. And silence is perfect. I think today we have so many things, even, you know, people with good intentions, so many things that distract us from Almighty God in His presence. You know? Even liturgically, I mean, there's music all the time, there's no silence, there's like, and that's why here at communion time, I like it even softer than what we have, and I'm going to get it there. But for right now, I mean, just no words, no anything, so we can have that time after just receiving the Lord For me, honestly, to receive Holy Communion and then just to go on singing and act just like nothing else, nothing. I mean, the most miraculous thing that could happen to me today is the reception of Jesus Christ truly present in me and in you. It's the most miraculous thing in all of these moments. What we're taking with us on that last breath. All of these glories. And so how is it that we can just start talking to the person next to us or go into song and whatever? And I don't get that. And I know, you know, all the churches do different things and whatever. I'm not concerned. I don't care what goes on. For me, nothing is more holy or more precious than my Jesus, our Jesus. And so after receiving this Jesus who changes my life and changes your life and can change anything in a second, and who tells us not to be afraid, not to be anxious, they become words only. The Eucharist becomes just like chewing a stick of gum. God forbid if we don't bring Jesus into that moment, and that's making ourselves hear him, and we can't hear him if we're in constant chatter or movement or looking at a bunch of stuff or whoever just walked through the door or whatever. All reverence, all holiness, you know. There's a woman that comes here pretty regularly. And when she first started coming here, I had my eyeball on her really closely because she would get as close as she could up to that altar. And for me, that's holy ground. I don't like anybody up there other than who is supposed to be at the appropriate time. So, you know, but the humility of this woman kind of calmed me. As I saw her, she kiss the Blessed Mother, Jesus, and just really in prayer time be right as close as she could possibly be allowed to Our Lady. You know, her son had a brain tumor, and he was in dental school, close to graduation, and it's like the worst time that this could possibly happen. It was her only child, and this mother's heart was suffering, sorrowful. And he had to have surgery. He had to go through a lot of stuff. But she begged for prayers. And her son was spared. Her son was spared. You know, anytime I see her come in and approach the statues or approach, but it's with such reverence, such holiness. She's engaging. It's not the statues themselves. It's not an image. It's what they represent, who they represent. There's an intimacy there. Thanksgiving there. Take it from me. If God should spare your life, you can't thank enough. You can't do enough. Anytime I get weary or burdened or whatever, I just remember my imploring God for healing and Our Lady coming to me and healing, her intercession for healing. I remember how good, how much Jesus has done for me, and with a grateful heart, I come into that prayer time, and I remember, and I think about all the things that I have so much to be thankful for. If we sit calmly and in silence, and just block out the noise for a while, it changes our lives. We won't have to ask Jesus, where are you? He will give you to know that he is with you. It's not in all the prayers. Please understand me. I'm not negating the necessity. It's prayer that gets us there. It's the vehicle. I'm not negating that at all. I live by that. It's not in all the prayers that brings us the merit. It's here. It's in the tear. It's in the unknown. So in that time of listening, God would give us his blessedness, his peace, to continue the journey until he says it's time to go home. And it's different for all of us. We just never know when that time is going to be. So instead of, Jesus, where are you? Jesus, help me to listen for you. And when you come into that prayer time, do what you need to do to work the heebie-jeebies out. Sing, whatever it is. Light your candle. Turn off the lights, whatever it is, to have calm. And thank him. Thank him, my Father first opened inside, for the gift of life, for being alive. Just for life. Do you know, if your mother or father or grandfather or seven generations back would have chosen somebody else instead of the spouse that they chose, you wouldn't be sitting here today. You were meant to be. We are meant to be. Each one of us, one by one, was put on this earth for a purpose. And that purpose is to satiate the thirst of Jesus, who died purposely and would do it again if only you were the one waiting. Or I should say, if you were the only one waiting. If you were the only person left, he would do it again. Such love that so many people would give up everything to follow him. And by being a Christian today, especially a Catholic, and there is a real dying to oneself. So let us thank God. And let us practice silence. It's holiness. It's a reverence. It's an understanding of who we are. But who God is. We need to have that reverence. We need to have that calm, silent time. Anna Amadali, remember Anna Amadali? And I think, Dominic, you had mentioned this one time, not too long ago. Anna Amadali used to come into the chapel and she'd bring all her stuff with her, all these books and prayers and everything, and she'd read and all that. And then one day she said, I don't do that anymore. I'm not doing that anymore because one day I was, you know, praying, and it just felt the Lord say to me, what if Frank Sinatra was sitting up there and singing a song? Would you be doing all this reading and whatever? Or even if he was just sitting there, would you be reading your book and stuff and doing whatever? No, she said, I'd be paying attention to Frank Sinatra. And so, God, why wouldn't we listen? And why shouldn't we have? I mean, what is wrong with us? That we don't have this expectant heart of like, I know you love me. I know you hear me. Not, where are you, God? But why am I not listening? Why am I so busy? Why am I, you know, trying to do five things at one time? Turn off the noise. Turn off that Dagon TV. Turn it off. I guarantee you, the next time you turn it back on, you're going to hear it again. There's all kinds of stuff on the news. And not much of it is very good. Try doing something different this year. You know, you don't have to throw your TV out. I didn't say that. Just regulate the timing so that you have that little bit of prayer time, that silent time. And when you pray, make it count, really. Don't just ramble off just to get through so you get it in, because who wants that? It's like talking to someone while they're on the computer and you're on the phone. Oh, pretty empty. God doesn't want that either. May God bless us and give us a greater understanding of silence. the holiness of listening for the Lord, and that we receive abundant blessings and directives from Him. God bless us. God bless our families. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.